Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath. God is good all the time. Thank you. In the book of Mark, chapter 5, we find a synagogue leader by the name Jairus. He comes to Jesus and falls on the feet of Jesus and asks Jesus to heal his daughter. His daughter was 12 years old, very sick, about to die. Jesus agrees, and on their way to Jairus' house, there comes people from Jairus' house, and they say to Jairus, "Don't trouble the teacher anymore. Your daughter is dead." And Jesus said to Jairus, "Fear not, only believe." There are many people who are going through a lot of challenges in our church, in our communities. And I'd like you to remember these words from Jesus. He says to you today, "Fear not, only believe in him and his powers." It's time for the announcements. Every Tuesday, we're having some prayer meetings at 7:30. The first Tuesday of the month, we come here at church. And any other Tuesdays, we do them on Zoom. And we've been sending some Zoom links through the newsletter. I'm not sure if anyone has received any emails regarding the prayer meetings. Can we raise some hands for those who have received some emails so that we can know how many people have received? Yeah, I can see maybe about less than 5 people have received the emails. So maybe we need to try something about it. Yeah. So I would like to call Danny to come up. Then after that, Gino will come up again.
Thank you, Moyo. Next week on Sabbath afternoon, we will have our a hike at R.J. Hamer Arboretum, which is near Olinda. So if anyone knows where Olinda is, it's about a 5-kilometer hike. Depending on how fast you walk, will take about 1.5 to 2 hours. And then after that, we'll close Sabbath together and enjoy some pizza. So if you want to come along to that, or you have some friends or family that might want to come along as well, please invite them to that. There will be first aiders and first aid kit and all of that available. But obviously, please make sure you bring along the appropriate clothing, water, and that you are also watching over your kids. That'd be wonderful. The contact details might be on the screen, but Gene will also send out the flyer, which will include my contact details. If you have any questions, please let me know. Thank you.
Good morning, church. I'll be doing the second reading for the membership transfer for Bristol Lamto today. We did the first reading last week if you missed it. I'll get straight into it. So a motion to move the membership of Bristol Lamto from Fern Tree Gully Seventh-day Adventist Church to Pakenham Seventh-day Adventist Church. Any seconder? All in favor? And any opposing? One. Good. And with that, we want to welcome Bristol Lamto to the Pakenham Seventh-day Adventist Church family. Thank you so much.
Church, happy Sabbath. It's time to praise the Lord in songs. Let's all stand as we sing our first hymn. Hymn 334. Let's all stand up as we sing our first song. Standing as we prepare to sing our second hymn.
Amazing Grace.
Amazing Grace.
It's time for the local church. It's time for the offerings. So our offerings today is goes to the local church budget. So this is the money that we're going to use to pay for the bills. Now it's getting colder and we need more of the heating system. So it would help us a lot. When you go to Malachi chapter 3, verse 10, it says, bring all the tithe to the storehouse, so that there may be some food in my house. Try me in this, and see if I'm not going to open the floodgates of heaven, so that I'll pour out all the blessings, that there may be no room for your house to store. Oh, it's there already.
Let's pray. Dear God, can you please have mercy for all? Thank you for this wonderful day. Bless us. Can you please bless the offering in the holy name? Amen.
Now it's time for the children's story. Today, you remain on your seats because there's a video coming up and there's a song as well to sing along.
The Lamb's Book of Life, Revelation 21, 27. Nothing impure will ever enter it, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. It's wonderful to know that we serve a living Savior. He is at this very moment preparing our homes in heaven. And one day soon, Jesus will break through the clouds and come back to this earth to claim his children. Satan, that old serpent, will be defeated. Then comes the greatest moment in history, when Jesus opens the Lamb's Book of Life. If you have asked Jesus to come into your heart, your name will be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Just think, God knows your name and has heard your prayers. If you've never asked Jesus into your heart, but you want to, just pray this little prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I believe that Jesus died on a cross for me, and I believe He rose again and lives today. Please forgive me of all my sins and let Jesus come into my heart. Amen.
Thank you for the song, Deep and Wide. It reminds me of my childhood. Now it's time for the offerings again. We've got two offerings. These are the last offerings. Thank you.
members of the church. Today, I'm going to read the scripture reading. The scripture reading is found in Acts chapter 1, verse 1 to 5. It reads, our New King James Version, the former accounts are made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach, unto the day in which he was taken up, after he through the Holy Spirit had given commandments to the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom he also presents himself alive after suffering by many infallible proofs, being seen by them during 40 days, and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. And being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me, for John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Thank you. Amen.
Let's all stand as we prepare our hearts for prayer with hymn 671.
And pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for sending your only Son to die for us. Hey Lord, we're coming to you now. We're all sinners, and we're asking you, Father, to forgive our sins. Lord, we thank you for the gift of life and for protecting us from the accident and diseases throughout the week. Lord, your people have come to your house to hear your word. They come here with a lot of problems in their lives. Some they want to revive their faith. Some they want encouragement. Some they want the reassurance. Dear Lord, we ask that from the sermon and from the songs that we're going to sing, people will find what they need today. Dear Lord, we're praying for older people. The winter has come, and dear Lord, some of them, they're on pension, and they cannot afford to pay for the gas, the heating system. Dear Lord, we ask that we as a church can help our older people on pension, so that they will be able to provide some heating system in their houses. Lord, we are now on flu season, and dear Father, I'm praying for your church, that you can protect your church from flu. Dear Lord, I'm also praying for the church that you give us your love, and share us, and so that we're able to share your love among us and to the community. Dear Father, there are many people who are sick in the church. Isabel's father is not feeling well, and she has gone home to be with his father and family. Dear Lord, my mother also is in hospital. We all pray for all other sick people, including my mother, Isabel's father, and others who are sick, that, Lord, may you heal them. Dear Father, may you restore their health. We're also praying for the pastor. Dear Lord, may strengthen him and pour your Holy Spirit among the church so that we can hear your word. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. After the sermon, there will be some elders here. Anyone who needs some prayers, you can come here. Thank you.
Happy Sabbath, church. Welcome to Pakenham, everybody. If you're visiting for the first time, welcome. If you're a regular visitor, we're glad that you're here. It's been a little while since I've been up here. I went to America, I came back, I took communion, and then I left for another 2 weeks. We had big camp, which was a real blessing. I got to spend the Easter long weekend with my middle son, Max, working in the little kinder division at big camp, which was a lot of fun. And then we were foolish enough, my wife and I, to decide to go to the Great Ocean Road with our three kids, not a fourth, no fourth, with our three kids to the Great Ocean Road for this week. The conference gave us some days off in lieu of big camp. So it's been good, but just so you know, I'm back, okay? Now I'm properly back. If you need your pastor, if you need a call, I'm back and we can get things going. We can get the ball rolling on a few things. But I'm good. I'm glad to be here. I'm really excited for one simple reason. It's because we get to start our sermon series in the book of Acts. Who's excited? Oh, yeah, good. I'm excited. When we finished in Luke just before Christmas, I was like, all right, we got to do Acts. And it's literally taken between Christmas and now to start because of the stops and the starts. So if you want to follow along, every week I will be teaching from the book of Acts. And basically, I will be preaching probably like three times to twice a month. And we'll have visiting speakers or our local elders sharing as well. But every time I'll be with you, I'll be teaching from the book of Acts. And I'm really excited to do this. We were in Luke, and just so you know, for context, Acts is part two of the story, okay? And just by way of introduction, this is not something I share as a brag, but something that really enriched my life, and I know most people can't do this, but when I was a university student studying to be a minister, I had this opportunity to go to the Mediterranean, to actually go to a lot of the places that are mentioned in the book of Acts. And it was such a blessing to actually be able to go to these places, not in some holy osmosis, I'm in the place Jesus walked and now it's transferring to me, nothing like that, but just to actually be in these places. To sort of, I know we're almost 2,000 years removed from these stories, but to experience some of that Mediterranean culture, to see what it's like, to smell the smells, you know, to walk. I mean, we traveled a lot on this trip. We started our trip in Rome, we ended in Egypt. And literally everything in between, we looked. We went to Turkey, to Greece, to Jerusalem, to Jordan. And you go to all of these places, and what struck me, we were on this trip for 6 weeks. We were in buses and planes. Sometimes we were on a boat. But you stop and you think as you're going through all of these places. Man, we've been at this for 6 weeks. Flying, driving, it's 40 degrees outside. I mean, there is this, you start to realize that there is this deep commitment to share Jesus that these first century Christians had, right? There's this really deep commitment to the point where they are not driving, they are not flying. These men and women are walking from town to town to share this faith that they have, to share something that has affected them in such a profound way. Like when you start to think about that, you're like, man, that's actually pretty it's a pretty profound thing. It's a very deep commitment that these people have. And it kind of challenged me just to think, just in spatial terms, that these people were prepared to go through so much for the God that they had encountered. So I want to journey with you this year, for the remainder of this year, through the story of Acts. Acts is probably one of the later books that were written in the New Testament. It's one of the longest, actually, in the New Testament. It covers the years of approximately 30 to 33 AD to the year 60 AD. So it covers about a 30-year span. And the length of the book is probably dictated by the length of the scroll Luke had to write on, which is a very interesting thing. But it is very long. He has a lot to say. But because of the length of the scroll, he cannot say everything he wants to say. Okay, this is about the church and its origins. This is by no means a history of the church. I mean, there are so many unanswered questions, and I'd encourage you to read the book of Acts. It is a real page-turner. It's just narrative. You're seeing one story from another flow into the next. So you're getting all of these stories, right? But as you're reading, you're like, well, okay, it starts with these 12 disciples who would become the 12 apostles, the 12 apostello, the 12 sent ones, okay? And it follows very closely to Peter. But you ask yourself, Peter eventually disappears. Like, well, where did Peter go? What's Peter doing? Where did the other disciples, where did James go? Where did Andrew go? We have no recollection of this in the book of Acts. We have a sense, and we might touch on this later on, but we have no sense from the book of Acts. It's not a history. I mean, Paul will go to prison in Rome, and we just don't know if he succeeded in his mission to talk to Caesar. We don't know what happened to him after he was in prison. Did he die? Some people think he did. Some people think he was set free. We just don't know. So it's not a comprehensive history. What it is it's God's retelling of the mission of the church. Now, usually two groups love the book of Acts for very different reasons. There are people who are very focused on evangelism, and they love the book of Acts. That's probably me. I love the book of Acts just to see how did they do things in that first century at a snail's pace. Remember, they're just walking around. How did they do things? So there's a group of people who are very interested from that perspective. That's me. Then there's another group of people who are very interested because of the supernatural things that are happening in this book. And let's just be honest, supernatural things happen in this book. There are angels, there are miracles, there are just like narrow escapes from death, okay? Incredible things happen. And probably our more charismatic brothers and sisters love the book of Acts for that reason. It's a very Holy Spirit-filled book. And we're going to be focusing on the Holy Spirit today, in fact. Now, what I want to propose to you is that the book of Acts, you cannot have one without the other. You cannot have mission without the Spirit. And to best understand the book of Acts, you need to bring Spirit and mission together, because that's how this book works. It's not a story of men and women who are like, we want to share Jesus and now we're going in our own strength. No, no. It's not just about miracles and people getting bitten by snakes and all sorts of crazy. All of this happens within the context of mission. You have to marry the two together to make sense of the book of Acts. And so all of that hopefully will help you understand. The book is addressed to Theophilus, who the book of Luke was addressed to. And Theophilus, we think, may have been a wealthy patron, or it may have been a nice little way that Luke was addressing the reader. We're not sure. Theophilus, Theo, God, Philo, love, lover, God lover, he's writing to somebody who loves God. Okay, so who is it? We're not 100% sure. It probably was a rich person. Was his name Theophilus? We're not 100% sure. But with that, we're going to jump into the book, and we've got a lot to cover today. So get into the book of Acts, Acts chapter 1 and verse 1, and we're going to walk through the first 10 verses together. And I want to take a little pause towards the end, because I want to focus in on some teachings of Jesus that help us better understand this book. So with that, let's read. I'm going to just say a quick prayer because I want to speak the words that are relevant for our community this morning. Father in heaven, Lord, we are here. We are ready to get into the word. We are looking at the story of the church. Jesus came with a mission. He taught, he preached, he did miracles, he healed, but he wanted to impart the qualities, the DNA of the church. And now that he's about to go to heaven, wherever he is right now, he will impart, he will inspire his followers to take up his mantle. And so as we look at these passages today, I pray that you'll speak through me, is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to pick up in verse 1 of the book of Acts, okay? Acts chapter 1 and verse 1. So it says, "In the first book, O Theophilus, I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and to teach." So the book of Acts assumes that you've read Luke. And if you have not been with us, if you didn't get to be here last year, lucky for you, we've got some quality guys at the sound desk over there. Do you want to wave, guys? There they are. They don't get acknowledged very often, but our great team there, they record every week our sermon. So you can go watch online at our website any message that we covered in the series on Luke. But Theophilus needs to know that we've talked about Jesus, okay? And all that he began to do. See, Jesus hasn't stopped doing just because Luke is done. Jesus hasn't stopped. He has begun a work. And that work continues today. Amen? Amen. Okay? And so we're going to be focusing on this work that Jesus begun and continues. We'll skip to verse 3. So Jesus presented himself alive to them, them being the disciples, the students literally of Jesus, after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. Verse 4, and while staying with them, and some translations say while eating with them, I think that's a nice little detail, while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, "You heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now." So this is a book, like I said, it's about mission, but that mission, key to that mission's success is the Holy Spirit. We're going to spend a lot of time reading about the Holy Spirit this year, okay? If you don't know about the Holy Spirit, who he is, what he does, we will see this year. Especially today, we're going to be looking at this. Now, Jesus says, you've heard me talk about the Spirit. You've heard me make reference to the Spirit. And we didn't get to talk about the Spirit all the time. We skipped over lots of things in Luke's gospel. Now, in particular, in Luke chapter 3 and Luke chapter 11, Jesus talks about the Spirit. We actually talked about this Luke chapter 11 at not last week's prayer meeting. I couldn't make it. I was on the Great Ocean Road. But the week before that, we talked about this in our prayer meeting. Please come. It's a great time, guys. In Luke 11, verse 13, Jesus said, "If you then, who are evil, you know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?" Jesus has told a story about a man who comes knocking at night. He needs something from his neighbor, and the neighbor's like, "Ah, please don't wake me up. My kids are asleep." Everybody slept in one big room. It's like camping, literally. Everybody's in one room, and it took forever to get your kids to sleep when you're camping. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Yeah? You have 3 kids under 7. It's called foolishness. But you don't want somebody coming to your house, knocking on the door, because it's going to wake up Macy, it's going to wake up Harry, it's going to wake up Max, and you actually just want to quickly deal with it. And so you're like, all right, what do you want? Okay, I'll give you what you want. And Jesus is saying, tongue-in-cheek, like, if we're prepared to be like that, how much more is God going to be generous? How much more is God going to be willing to give what we need, what we need to ask from him? And so he says these words, look, if you want the Holy Spirit, just ask, don't hesitate. So guys, so many of us hesitate to come to God. So many of us hesitate to talk to him about the things we need, the things we want. And Jesus is saying, guys, I want to give the Holy Spirit to you generously. Do we ask generously for the Holy Spirit? It's not something I ask for in copious amounts, I must admit. Okay? On this trip to America, I'm sort of seeing things, different churches, how they operate. Churches that are very missional, they're very focused on the community, getting out of their four walls and into society. And I'm praying and I'm reflecting as I'm driving along with my good friend, Pastor Fraser Catton. And I know this might sound weird, but I'm praying and I'm saying, God, what do you need me to know? What do you need me to understand from what I'm seeing, what I've been learning? And one word keeps coming back to me time and time again. And that word is death. Like, oh, I'm in America, hooray. God, what do you need me to see? Die. Oh, okay, that's nice. Am I going to die? No, just you need to look at what it means to die in Scripture. And friends, to receive the Spirit, it's all about dying to self. And we are going to explore this over quite possibly next week. We're going to look at the baptism of the Holy Spirit. But what does it really mean to die? To receive the Holy Spirit into your life. And we really ask for it. Because God is saying he wants to give it generously. So we have him promising. He's talked about this. Okay? And we're going to revisit more of Jesus' words later. But we pick up in verse 6, so he says, so when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? On the minds of the disciples, they are good Jewish people, and you need to read Scripture actually often through a Jewish lens. You need to put some Jewish glasses on to understand what they're thinking. You see, the Jews, their primary concern is, when will this kingdom, they still think this kingdom is going to be about the might of Israel coming to suppress Rome. Israel is going to come and establish itself as the rightful, you know, kingdom that is going to rule everybody. It's going to conquer everyone. It's going to vanquish everyone. Okay, that's what they are expecting. And that's their hope. And look, I would be lying to you if I said Scripture does not address this. The New Testament, in fact, does talk about this. We don't really look at it a whole lot as Seventh-day Adventists. It does focus on this. Maybe I would differ with a lot of our Christian brothers on the interpretation of how this thing will work. It's a whole other sermon. But they are interested. Jesus, when are we actually going to see this kingdom? And Jesus' answer is so telling. In verse 7, he said to them, it is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. Okay? In our Sabbath school question this morning, I was asked, what do you think, Pastor Ryan, about focusing on the end of the world? And I was like, wow, it's not my favorite pastime. I don't know about for some of you, but a lot of Seventh-day Adventists, we love to look at all of the events that are happening. If Jesus were here, we would ask him, maybe not when is Israel going to be made Israel. We're going to ask, when is this doomsday event going to happen? And when's the Pope going to do that? And when's the American president going to say this? That's what we would ask. And I think to that, Jesus would in fact say, it is not for you to know the times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. Are we okay with that? I'm not saying discard everything, forget about everything. Things are going to happen, right? Are we told in Scripture things are going to happen? Yeah, some pretty crazy things are going to happen. But Jesus says, don't make that the sole focus of what we're doing. Watch what he says. Verse 8. You will receive power, okay? You will receive power. And that word power, anytime you see it, 9 times out of 10, it's the Greek word dunamis, dynamite. Not just power like, you know, when we bring our caravan home from camping, it's a pop-up trailer thing, it's a little Jayco and the rooms pop out on the side. We live in a row of townhouses and we can't actually I can't... Guys, I hope the men do not see me as less of a man. I can't reverse my trailer down the driveway. I practiced at the Dandenong Showgrounds, but we've got a neighbor who parks here and a neighbor there, and I've got to, like, sort of just shimmy my way in, and I'm just like, Emma, I can't do this. So what we do is we drive in, we unhitch the trailer, we push the trailer into the neighbor's parking area, then I drive the caravan around, and Emma and I, with our dunamis power, we have to push the thing, twist, turn it around. I then can hook the four-wheel drive and back it the rest of the way, okay? But man, you need dunamis power to do that. The other day, we came back from big camp. It had been raining cats and dogs, and I'm pushing, and I'm sliding, and I look like a fool, and I, God, I need your strength. Like, guys, to do what Jesus is calling us to do in the book of Acts, what he's calling his disciples to do, it's not just feeble Pastor Ryan energy. I read books for a living, okay? That's my job. I don't lift heavy things. I will admit that. You need some supernatural strength to do what God is calling us to do. And I think that's something maybe the church loses sight of from time to time. I like preaching from here because as I preach to you, I often will see people walking by, sometimes kids running up the steps. And when I read this, what I see in Scripture, God is saying, it's going to take dunamis power to reach these people. Do you understand that? It's not just simple me trying to flex and do anything in my own strength. It's going to take, but you will receive power. Not just lower P power, as my grandfather would say, uppercase P, uppercase O, uppercase W, uppercase E, uppercase R. Power. Bold. That's what it's going to take to do this job. So many of you guys have asked me, what are we going to do in evangelism this or an outreach that? For me, maybe call this lazy, but interpret this how you will. I don't want to take a step until I know we are operating in the strength of the Holy Spirit. That for me is 100%. Because any time I've been a part of something where we didn't pray for God to work in and through us, we were just spinning our wheels. Jesus says, don't focus on Israel's becoming a big prominent superpower. Adventist Church of the 21st century, don't make your soul focus the Pope and Rome and America and all this. Like, look at those things, sure, but here's what you need to do. You will receive power, dunamis, when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. And I think he's got this veiled answer here. But guys, the thing you're actually hoping for will happen when you receive the Holy Spirit. Have you ever thought, Seventh-day Adventist Church here today and friends who are visiting, that the things we are wanting to see will happen when there is a Spirit-filled people going out into the world? And the world is actually responding to a Spirit-filled people who are pushing all of their buttons and annoying them because, man, these God people are just different. We're waiting for something to happen, but God's waiting for us to be filled. And when we're filled and we're having an impact in the world, that's when people are going to notice and go, huh, we've got to do something about these people. They're annoying us. They're grating on us. I mean, that's how it happens in the third world. I love to read books about this. It only seems to happen when God's people are triggered and they are responding and they're in activity. It's not going to happen because we're sitting here today on Sabbath. We pray, God, thank you that we're here in Sabbath and we are free from persecution. We're free from persecution because we're not agitating anyone. I don't want to be rude and I don't want us to have this militant, we must go and wage war. No. I don't think like that. But the reality is, as I read Scripture, persecution comes when people go out into the world filled with God. Literally, he says, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come and you will be my witness. The word witness is martyr. You will be my martyr when you are filled with the Spirit and go out into the world. He's not necessarily saying you're going to die, but there's almost this veiled reference. Things are going to happen once you've been filled with the Spirit. Is that making sense? So to this end, people are like, what is the book of Acts called? It's literally called the Acts of the Apostles. But some have argued that maybe it really should be called the Acts of the Holy Spirit. If we're wanting to see God work in our church today, we need the Acts of the Holy Spirit working in and through us, right? That's what this book is all about. So Jesus now has mentioned twice that the Holy Spirit is really important. He says, you know, you should remember my words on this. And I'm going to jump back into the Gospels. I'm going to actually go to John. Next week, we're going to look at Luke talking a bit about the Spirit. But I want you to go to John because I think this is really important. For us to make sense of what we're about to see, we need to understand more about the Spirit. So go to John 16 if you can. And we're going to read a few verses. Here, Jesus is talking about the Spirit in John 16. John 16, and we're going to pick up in verse 7. So in verse 7, Jesus says, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth." Now, I want you to notice how many times the word "you" is referenced. "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you." How many times does Jesus mention "you" or "your" in some capacity? Anyone? Four times. Now in Scripture, maybe you know, maybe you don't know. Bible repeats something twice, kind of important. Bible references something three times in a short period, in a short space. That's really focused, guys. If the Bible mentions something four times, well, that's just usually not a quantifiable thing you see. But here we see Jesus references "you" four times. He wants to give you the Holy Spirit. He thinks that you should receive the Holy Spirit. And if you're counting, he mentions, "I will do this" five times. I want to give you the Holy Spirit. This is a big deal for Jesus that, remember this, you receive dynamite power. Okay? Now, I keep pausing because I don't know if it's the Spirit or my own mind. Little things come into mind. We're not talking about walking up walls or running around waving flags. You know what I'm talking about when I say receive power, right? It's the indwelling of Jesus to be who he's called us and designed us to be. It's to be that witness. It's not necessarily to do anything supernatural per se, but it's just to have the indwelling of God inside of us. And things happen when God lives inside of us. But in John, he's saying, you guys need to realize I am giving you this gift. This is for our advantage, church, to receive this gift. Note that the Comforter is only going to come, this Holy Spirit will only come when Jesus goes away. In verse 8, he says, "And when he comes," and I'm going to add in brackets here because it doesn't say it, but you could almost add it, "when he comes," in brackets, "to you, he will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment." Notice what's happening here. It's only until you receive the Spirit that the world is actually going to prick their ears up. The world does not care. The world will not notice. The world will not see our church. The world will not, you know, they won't give a flying anything about our church until we are filled with the Spirit. Can you see that? When he comes, in quotations, "to you," he will convict the world. It only happens when we are infilled with the Spirit. This is when things start to happen, friends. Why is Jesus making such a big deal of this? I'll give you a practical example. I don't want to throw anyone under the bus, but there's a church that meets here on a Sunday. Pastor Richard Schoenmaker, a good friend. I meet with a group of pastors from time to time, all the Pakenham pastors. We talk about the challenges of ministry. They're good, God-fearing people. And time and time and again, in our group meetings, they've said, look, we've tried this approach to reaching the community. We've tried that. Everybody has tried letterboxing the entire community. I know some of you guys live in the Lakeside area. Only late last year, there was a big letterbox drop of Alpha Course. You guys know Alpha Course? Alpha is kind of like the major outreach that the evangelical church uses, if you're Baptist or Pentecostal or Presbyterian. They use Alpha Course. I've looked at it. It's actually pretty good. And a major letterbox drop was done right here in Pakenham in the Lakeside area. Over 1,000 homes letterboxed. How many people came? 4. And you know what? People like, you know, that's still 4 people for the kingdom. And I say, amen. But when I read this, I actually think it's being filled with the Spirit, which is the best invitation you could have. It's when you're filled with the Spirit, people are going to be like, man, that guy's camping with 3 kids and he hasn't lost his cool. I lost my cool. that's why he's this example. They'd be like, man, what's up with this guy? They're like, hey, you've been pretty cool cucumber, man. It's the Spirit living inside of me, my brother. I need to have him. How many parents would want to have the Holy Spirit if they knew you could keep their cool with their kids? I'm telling you, so many would say, I want that. Some of the parents are laughing who still remember what it's like to have kids. But guys, I'm not saying letterboxing is bad. I'm not saying that running the Revelation seminar is bad. But guys, it won't make a difference if you and I aren't filled with God's Holy Spirit. Can you see that from Jesus' words? Okay? This is my big focus. This is why I really want to preach through this story. Because I want us to see what happens. These stories were meant for us to be inspired. In verse 9, well, I'll read verse 8 again. When he comes to you, he will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. In verse 9, Jesus continues, he's going to convict the world concerning sin because they do not believe in me, concerning righteousness because I go to the Father and you'll see me no longer, and concerning judgment because the ruler of this world is judged. Look at the ways that the Holy Spirit impacts people's lives when we allow him to live inside of us. When the dynamite power is unleashed, Jesus is saying, the world's actually going to, you don't need a, I don't know how it's going to work, but the world's going to realize that they have a sin problem. The world's going to realize that there's a standard that is so far above what they know. It's called righteousness, but it's something that they can attain. They're going to realize that, and they're going to realize that the person that they have maybe knowingly or unknowingly following, that person is being judged because their system in which they have proposed that's going to lead to life and joy and contentment, it's actually baseless. It's actually useless. The world will be convicted of these things when we are filled with the Spirit. Amen? Isn't that what we want to have for our family, for our friends, for our work colleagues? Friends, it's when Jesus lives inside of us through the Holy Spirit that incredible things start to happen. He continues in verse 13, when the Spirit of truth come, he will, and watch this, I've got a rapid fire because I'm using up my time. In verse 13, he'll guide you into all truth, okay? He's not going to speak on his own authority. The Holy Spirit, it's not about him. But whatever he hears, he will speak and he will declare to you the things that are to come. So he's not speaking on his own accord. He's speaking from what God is putting in front of him to speak. Okay? In verse 14, he will glorify me. The Spirit will glorify Jesus through our lives. He will take what is mine, what is Jesus's, and he's going to give it to you. He's going to declare it to you. And finally, verse 15, all that the Father has is mine. Therefore, I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. There seems to be this kind of divine pass the parcel happening. Jesus is receiving from the Father, and Jesus is handing it over to the Holy Spirit, who is now handing it over to us. And the cool thing about this Pass the Parcel game is we get to open at every stage. Who likes Pass the Parcel? Who hasn't played Pass the Parcel in over 10 years of the whole church? God wants you to play Pass the Parcel, friends. He's so excited for you to open what he has for you, okay? Things happen when we let the Spirit live inside of us. When we let this power, this, think about this, the Holy Spirit is God. And at God's word, this whole world came into existence. And now that God, through the Holy Spirit, wants to indwell you, what possibilities could happen in your little ecosystem as the God of this universe lives inside of you and now starts to affect the world around you? Things will start to come to life. And that's the point of all of this. This kingdom is a kingdom unlike any other kingdom. God is wanting to do something incredible. I want to read this quote and we'll just about land the plane. This is a quote I saw in one of my commentaries as I was reading this week because I thought it was worth mentioning. It says, "Friends, the Spirit, however, is more than the necessary means to fulfill a task. He's not just a means to an end. The connection of the Holy Spirit and the experience of God as Father suggests that the presence of the Holy Spirit is part of a close family relationship with God." They're saying what we're doing here, it's not we're just, God's not just giving us the Holy Spirit so we can be amazing. He's actually allowing us to enter into his family, right? I always like to think of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit as family. And we are being invited into that family. The Spirit is a person of the Trinity. And if you don't believe that, you need to find another church or talk to me. I'm very serious on that. We believe in the Godhead at this church. Until we do, nothing happens. And you can go reconcile that in your own thoughts if you disagree with me. But I see God is inviting us to have a dynamic relationship with the third person of the Godhead, to have a friendship with him. The emphasis on the Spirit as a gift indicates that the Spirit's presence is a powerful experience of God's grace. And so we come back to Acts, and then we finish in chapter 1, verse 9. "And when Jesus, he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and the cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes. And they said," in verse 11, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus who was taken up for you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." And friends, I like to think that this is the bookend that we need to think about. We are Seventh-day Adventists. In case you don't know what that means, we think the Sabbath is a really important day. It reveals a lot about God, what he's done. He's rescued us. He's redeemed us. But he's also a creator God. We rest on the Sabbath because he created and because he's delivered us. Amen? But the Adventist part says we are looking forward to Jesus' coming back. We are so ready for this moment to happen. As much as I love Big Camp, Elmore inspires me to look forward to heaven. It's just a dry, flat dust bowl. Anybody know what I'm talking about? My caravan is covered in dust. We have to sweep it and clean everything. I'm looking forward to just whatever heaven has. I know it's going to be better than a dust bowl. But friends, I feel like Jesus, he says these words and he goes. And, you know, they say when somebody leaves or somebody dies, the last things they say are the most important things. I connected with my cousin on this trip who I've only met four times, but it's weird how family ties can just connect you instantly. Do you know what I'm talking about? And she's like the older sister I never had. She's 10 years older. And I leave her and I just said, you know what? I just love you so much. And we just like hugged for 5 minutes. It was a real emotional moment. But that's what I needed. I wanted her to know that. I love you. And even though we literally live on the other side of the planet, you've got somebody who cares about you. That's what I wanted her to know. Jesus wanted his people to know when he left, I will come back when you have finished the mission of being spirit-filled people who've gone into the world. We talk about, you know, bringing the message of Jesus, the three angels' message. Have you ever stopped to think the gospel can go into the whole world, but that's not the mission complete? It's the message of Jesus gone into the world through a spirit-filled people. Sometimes I wonder, has the message gone into the whole world? Maybe it has by now, but has it been through a spirit-filled people? I don't think it has yet. Maybe in little pockets here and there, but maybe in Australia, it is yet to happen through spirit-filled people. Maybe there are little churches here and there happening, but I would love for Pakenham Church to be a church that is spirit-filled going into the world. With that, I'm going to invite our singers to come and sing our final song. It's one of my favorites. It's a song we sang in Dandenong Church when I was growing up all the time, and that's Seeking the Lost. As we sing Seeking the Lost, I want you to think we're seeking the lost as spirit-filled people. Next week, we're going to look a little bit more about what it means and how we get to become a spirit-filled person. But I want to get your brain flowing for this week, okay? I want you to be challenged as to, you know, okay, God, I want this. How do we do this? That's the right question to ask. Let's sing. Father in heaven, Lord, in these opening few verses of Acts, Jesus invites us to reflect on his teachings about the Holy Spirit. The book of Acts does not happen, the Mediterranean world does not get turned upside down in 30 short years. Dynamite power does not get exploded upon the world stage without the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. Jesus does not come back. You do not come back until the explosive power of the Holy Spirit is unleashed on this world. And you are calling Christians of all creeds, of all stripes, to be filled with the Spirit to this end. And you're calling our community. We are a community that prides itself on knowing things, of being able to read scripture, of studying deep topics out. But it all means nothing unless we are filled with your dynamite power, unless we are filled with the person of the Holy Spirit. So Jesus, you are inviting us as we journey through Acts, as we are watching incredible things happen. Those incredible things would be so completely far-fetched unless it were for the Holy Spirit. And those same things can happen again in the world today, but you are asking church and individual and families to be filled with your Holy Spirit. And so, Father, I just want to pray as we continue to journey through this book that you will help us to orient our lives in such a way that we can receive the Holy Spirit into our lives. It's not just something that happens once, but it's something we go for day after day. Fill us with your Holy Spirit. And so I just want to pray that over our church. Journey with us, and thank you so much for this story that you inspired Luke to write down. In this book, in this story, we get to see so much of what it means to be the church in the last times. So thank you for this word. We pray all of this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you, church. Happy Sabbath.